A mediocre teacher explains, a good teacher demonstrates, and a great teacher inspires. A journey which began over 100 years ago, this is the story of Guru Har Gobind Sahib Khalsa College, also known as the Wonder in Rural Hinterland.
Hi, Dr. Manu, IQAC coordinator of the college, is here to present the brief proceedings of day two. Yesterday, that is day two, Professor Amya Kumar Raj, advisor NAC, was their resource person. Professor Amya deliberated on criteria two, that is teaching, learning, and evaluation. He brainstormed the audience with the status of higher education, transition of education from pre-independence era to post-independence era. Sir facilitated the participants with the genesis of vision of NAC, mission of NAC, the parameters of quality assurance and sustenance. Professor Amya elucidated the detailed outline of revised accreditation framework, stressing on the qualitative and the quantitative metrics, the key indicators of all the 7 criteria of assessment and accreditation process, with special focus on criterion 2. Professor Amya unfolded innovative teaching techniques like GeoGlass, smartwatch, quiz, word puzzle, etc. The learned resource person managed to decipher the somewhat complex concept of program outcomes and course outcomes for various programs, their mapping, and hence their attainment. And he also shed light on peer assessment and system-generated score, the paradigm shift from instruction to learning. Sir elucidated that quality and sustenance, for quality and sustenance, responsiveness to change is the dire need. Am I audible, Pargat sir?
Yeah, you are audible.
Okay. Yes,
ma'am, please.
So responsiveness to the change is a dire need. Change from passive teaching methods to participative teaching methods. Change from traditional pre-technology teaching to blended, or in other words, technology-based teaching. In the light of Gardner's theory of multiple intelligence, sir emphasized that be it faculty or the students, either of them, it is peremptory to identify prominent intelligence and least intelligence and strengthen the areas where improvement is demanded. SWOT analysis of every institution is a much needed affair. Sir concluded his deliberation by delineating very practical tips to become a good teacher, innovations in teaching, continuous improvement of student learning, role of faculty in making students better learners, by illustrating a teacher being reactive as well as proactive. He concluded his presentation with beautiful words, the essence of which was that to survive, friends, to survive, you need to be willing to change. And for that, you need to be intuitive. So day two, the faculty development program terminated with a very good note, with a question answer session, in which Professor Amya was able to satisfy all the participants with his pertinent responses. So we are highly thankful and grateful to Professor Amya for having such a great session. So that was the proceedings for day two. Now I request our worthy principal, Dr. Pargat Singh Archa, to formally welcome the eminent speaker and the participants.
Thank you, Dr. Manu. Person of A. Esteemed principals and IQAC coordinators from different colleges, respected participants from our 5 mentee colleges, and learned faculty members from colleges and universities across the nation. Dear participants, it gives me immense pleasure in welcoming all of you on behalf of the management committee and staff of GHG Khalsa College of Education Guru Sarsodar to the third day of this 7 days workshop on NAAC revised accreditation framework. Today we will be enlightened by Professor E. Ram Ganesh ji on criteria 3, that is research, innovation and extension. There may be some question in your mind while you are preparing documents for your SSR, questions related to nature of research grants, incubation center, government and non-government agencies, ecosystem for innovations regarding inclusion of publications in journal when UGC list is itself a dynamic in nature, how to see the impact of an extension activity, etc. So these are the pertinent questions which comes before us when we are preparing our NAAC report. So let us ponder upon these issues in this session, and you all are invited to participate in the question answer session at 5:30 p.m.
Most distinguished principal, Dr. Barkat Singh, GHE Khalsa College of Education, Punjab. IQAC coordinator of the GHC College of Education, learned participants, principals, IQAC coordinators, friends, very good evening to all of you. First of all, I would like to thank Dr. Barkat Singh for extending one more opportunity, yet another opportunity for me to be with you, to connect myself with you for discussing criteria 3. I think it is a very good initiative taken by GHC Khalsa College of Education for updating the neighboring colleges and colleges across the country on revised accreditation assessment and accreditation framework. I think two good speakers, we have already spoken to you. Even I listened to the first speaker, but I could not listen to the second speaker because I was assigned some other task to be accomplished. So in that way, the third criteria is assigned to me. Very important criteria, research. There is one bit of word jargon we cannot avoid is research. You know, research really matters. It gives me great impetus to remember the great saying of the first Prime Minister of independent India, Sri Jawaharlal Nehru ji. But for quality education, the economic growth and social transformation would not be feasible to India. Economic growth and social transformation would not be feasible to India. Even the recent development in Government of India is the focus of achieving Atmanirbhar India, self-reliant India, for which research, we have to take cognizance of research. And it is a teamwork, it is not a one-man show, it is a teamwork now. Everybody has to got to do, and academia plays a vital role now. Being an academia, you have got to play a vital role in promoting quality culture, research culture in India, or research culture in the premises, in your premises, and in turn India. So therefore, you have got to have the research awareness, perhaps, and then quality of research, and then the research culture, which is very important. You see, National Science and Technology Policy, which was adopted in 1958, and India invested only 0.58% of its GDP for research and development in sciences and humanities. Then it has been recast, redefined in 2013 as National Education, National science and innovation technology policy. And India invested for about 1.3% of its GDP as an expenditure for research and development in science and technology, even in humanities. But you see the development right now, India has come forward to invest 4.3% of its GDP as an expenditure, as an investment for research and development in various domains of higher education. So it is a good symptom. Government of India has several initiatives, especially to promote research in India, especially promote research in higher education institutions is part of the country. As you are all aware, India is the largest higher education system, and we must all sincerely thank our government of India for investing 4.3, almost 5% of its GDP for promoting research initiatives in India. So it has got several initiatives. Perhaps you can't find even Western countries, this sort of initiatives in Western countries. The fellowship that we offer now to the students and researcher, various other countries, even in the West, are not able to compete to India. Because India almost provides a lot of scholarship, fellowship for the students and young researchers. There are certain initiatives you are aware, that is, you know, SPARC, that is like, you know, the scheme on academic and research collaboration. Academic and research SPARC, you know, as academic and research collaboration. And then impactful policy research in social sciences by ICSR. Various initiatives have been taken, like, you know, college with the potential for excellence, university with the potential for excellence, institute of eminence, college of excellence. You know, so many funding agencies, like through UGC, AICTE, DST, DPT, ICSSR. So many funding agencies come forward to provide fellowship for good research proposals. In that way, government of India has been taken a lot of initiatives to promote research in higher education institution in India especially. I still remember when I was a registrar for some time in our university, couple of years, I was so happy to note that my colleagues used to attract or mobilize funding from different funding agencies in India and abroad. Especially India, for crores and crores of money, especially science faculty members. I was really happy to sign on the proposal. Because whenever I sign on the proposal, they will get, you know, the research awarded. So in that way, but one thing which I was very keen to note, which I would like to keep you informed, that when they take up a project for 2 crores or 3 crores, almost 50% of their money they attract from funding agencies of government of India is invested in foreign countries. 50% of the money, I would like to reiterate, 50% of the money they attract from funding agencies of government of India or NGOs is invested in foreign countries for purchasing equipments like confocal microscope, the modern equipments like, and I used to feel, don't we have the adequate potential to manufacture confocal microscope or all high profile apparatus and instruments? Why should we invest our money in foreign countries? Why can't we put in our potential? Because we have got tremendous potential. And we are able to supply knowledge across the world. Can you spot out any country without the contribution of India? Certainly not. So we have got wonderful brains in India, but we invest our money in foreign countries. This is the one thing that we all have to note down. So therefore, it is a high time for all of us to take cognition that we have to improve the quality of research in this part of the country. I am going to give you a lot of statistics which will make you realize the importance of improving quality in research in higher education institutions, especially. So now we have to, you know, UGC, AICTE, DST, DBT, all these high profile institutions, all these higher education institutions in different domain launch lot of initiatives, but one thing that we have to note, are we self-reliant? That is a big question now. Therefore, NAC has been taking lot of initiatives and it has been redesigning all the key indicators and criteria in such a way the knowledge that we share with our students or our stakeholder must be useful to the society. It has to create an impact. Normally, I used to say there must be a paradigm shift from impact factor to social impact. That's very important. We researchers are all fond of, you know, improving our H index, our impact factor in terms of publishing our thoughts in high profile journals or journals of, you know, journals affiliated by Scopus or PubMed or Clarivate or Web of Science, Web of Knowledge. It is good, but not adequate. What I wanted to say is you must understand the paradigm shift which has to happen from impact factor to social impact. So whatever initiatives we take in research must have social impact. Socially impactful research is very important. Socially impactful research. It has to create impact. I would like to quote a very good example, that is Punjab Agriculture University, one of the famous universities, agriculture universities in this country is Punjab Agriculture University, which is known for high profile research in agriculture. I think Punjab Agriculture University and Tamil Nadu Agriculture University. And they are the forerunners in India, especially mooting out lot of researchers to mitigate the social issues, yes, with a special reference to agriculture and horticulture. So in that way, our initiative, research initiative, must create social impact. Then only we will be able to achieve Atmanirbhar India, self-reliant India. So I think this is a great opportunity for me, so that I would be able to share my thoughts with you and you also get benefited in terms of your appearing before NAC, in terms of all criteria. And you see, every day, you know, it is well organized. Every day, one speaker will throw insights on a particular criteria. In that way, today, we are going to discuss, you know, the third criteria, research, innovation, and extension. Friend, paradigm shift in research trends is mandatory, need of the hour, way forward. For the reason, paradigm shift is a trump card to your research. Because research, education and research have no boundary, because for they are seamless. Education and research have no boundary, for they are seamless. Because problems are unlimited. Problems do not remain the same. India is the second highly populated country in the globe. Making India self-sufficient is not an easy task. Therefore, we have to put our initiatives. Every individual has to contribute. Every academia has to contribute. Every industry has to contribute. So academia industry cluster that we are going to discuss about. So education research are seamless because they have no boundary. Why? The problems are many. Problems are many now. As I rightly pointed out, I'm going to list out, you know, some of the problems which I have come across, but still number of problems which remain unattempted. Which remain, you see, the academic institution is called Vidya. In Sanskrit, Vidya means Vidyalaya. It is a place which dispels darkness. It is a place which dispels darkness. Therefore, many of the problems we encounter remain unanswered. Therefore, so many people are in dark. I don't want to name some of the states because I have been traveling to different states, but I don't want to name the states, but still, when I look at some of the states, really, I feel worried. I am really worried that, you know, they are not able to even get the basic amenities, the basic survival. They are struggling with the basic survival. So in that way, now research must advance our knowledge and wisdom. That's very important. That is why the Australian researcher Bese rightly pointed out, rightly defined, education is systematic, critical, and self-critical inquiry which aims at the advancement of knowledge and wisdom. So in that way, advancement of knowledge and wisdom is very important. Whatever the research initiative you take, advancement of knowledge and wisdom is very important. You see, the Western countries, they have the philosophy of publish or perish. Publish or perish. So I do research because it is warranted. I do research because it is warranted in that way. So they come across problems. To encounter the problem, to find the solution for the problems, they undertake research. So in that way, we have to have the policy, philosophy of publish or perish. That is very important. So therefore, paradigm shift is very important. And our research must be inclined towards sustainable development goals. See, UNESCO came out with the sustainable development goals. You see, we have to eradicate poverty. We have to get rid of hunger. We have to take care of good health and well-being, quality education, gender equality, clean water and sanitation, affordable and clean energy, decent work and economic growth, industry innovation, infrastructure, reduced inequalities, sustainable cities and communities, climate action, life below water. You know, the water is going to be rare commodity. Even right now in Delhi, one of a particular part of Delhi has got serious scarcity of water. Now we have to take, our research has to really address the social issues. Our research has to address the social issues and national agenda. Very important, because they are all our brothers and sisters. Everybody has to share our potential to address the social issue and national agenda. So in that way, whatever the research that you take up, which must address the sustainable development goals, that is very important. So we should not do research for sake of doing. There is a verse in India, theses and dissertations take their shelter in the shelves of the library, which are quite often untouched. So we should not do research for sake of doing it, because Human mind achieves what it believes. If you think your research will be useful, then you will be committed. You will be accountable. And some of you are IQAC coordinators. Some of you are the principals of higher learning institutions. We'll have to really think, because academia plays a vital role. That is why, you know, Professor Kothari, D.S. Kothari, former chairman of UGC, said, the destiny of India is being shaped in your classroom. Therefore, academia has to come forward to address the social issues and national agenda. It's very important. Therefore, research initiatives, sustainable goals. Why I say, you see, my saying is meaningful, is relevant to NAC accreditation. That is why if you read out the key indicators, you would understand what kind of social impact the particular institution makes in terms of its research initiatives. This is the idea of NAC. Now what happened when you are forced to do it, sometime it will happen. And you would be able to really develop inclination to achieve the sustainable development goals towards society. That is why I am spelling out sustainable goals. Friends, I would like to throw an idea called golden spiral, idea of impact, golden spiral. Therefore, NAC will be very conscious and very keen when they come down to your campus that what kind of social impact you create in terms of your research initiatives. Perhaps you would have published number of articles, you would have written number of books, you would have improved your impact factor or H index or I10 index. But NAC is very keen in looking at your initiative, research initiatives, with a special reference to social impact. That's very important. So idea to impact, golden spiral, I would say. The spiral say the first thing is you see or visit the society. Visit the people. Visit the realm of their affairs. Therefore, you would understand, unless you visit them, you ask them, you know, Bible says, knock it shall be opened unto you. Ask it shall be given unto you. In that way, if you go and see, if you penetrate through the society in terms of your initiatives, you would understand their hardship. You would understand the problems the rural economy, the rural population of India encounter. So in that way, you go to the place where your research initiatives would be meaningful. You go and ask people, they will come out with a number of problems. Everybody has got, you know, tremendous potential. Only thing is your initiatives must be meticulous. So you can just listen to the story. You can listen to the story narrated by villagers, rural people, or urban people, or semi-urban people. Now you will get an idea so that you can try a project in terms of your research initiatives. Sometime you can do it. Sometime you can have the, you can seek the help from industry. That is why we, NAC, even UGC, has been insisting all higher education institutions to establish academia industry cluster sometime. Sometime you can do it, or you can take partnership from industry or any other organization or any other NGO. Or that is why we call PPP model, public-private partnership model. So you talk to the, see the people, see the society, ask them, visit them, you ask them their needs. They will tell you a lot of story, and you can, that will give you a beautiful idea for you to share your research potential. And through research potential, now you would be able to find a solution that will create a social impact. Now that is why we call R&D, that is research and development, education and society. These are the four important parameters, determinants: research, development, education and society. You have to bring out an interface or a good interaction among research, development, or education, research, development and society, creating social impact. That's very important. So whenever we NAC peer team comes down to your campus, it will be bother about the social impact that you have created in terms of your research initiatives. Is very important, either by yourself or getting knowledge partnership, skill partnership from your industry or NGO or any other organization. This is very important. I request all of you, all the participants, to take cognizance, make a note on it, create, understand the golden spiral. Go to them, ask them. They will give you research proposal. You don't have to design research proposal. A villager, an farmers, agriculturalist, industrialist, illiterates will give you research proposal for which you can share your potential. You put forth your idea so that you would be able to test a solution and check with them. If it is useful to them, you are really patenting your research. Your initiative is boon to them. So in that way, you should understand the golden spiral. Friend, as I told you, there must be a shift from impact factor to social impact. Still, you go through the surgicals in India. We have got thousands and thousands of surgicals in India. But none of the surgical sometime is able to cater to the needs of a child with special needs. A child which is afflicted by cerebral palsy, autism, mentally disordered, mentally challenged. And this wheelchair is exported from America. This is not made in India. Therefore, there are so many problems which are unaddressed. Still, these children are in dark. The children with the special needs are in dark. We don't have adequate assistive technologies to cater them. State governments and central governments launch a lot of initiatives to help them. But what about the research initiatives? When I have been to IIT Mumbai recently, I came across a beautiful device called the smart stethoscope, what you see in the PowerPoint. Smart stethoscope. The blue color device is a beautiful device which is appended in the, which is connected in the stethoscope, normal stethoscope. You know, the IIT undergraduate students went to the tribal village in Maharashtra and they identified a problem that if at all the tribal villagers had to consult the doctor, they had to travel for about 100 kilometers. Therefore, they were hesitant traveling because they could not afford. And many villagers were dying without consulting doctors. So this problem was identified by undergraduate students cutting across different faculties and they wanted to help them. This really gave them intuition. This really gave them problem because they visited the villages, they narrated the story, they got an idea, they wanted to create a social impact and they have researched and contributed a beautiful device which can be connected with stethoscope that will read and make the readings, the heartbeats, it will read the heartbeats and make reading, and that will be sent across to the doctors through email, and the through email, and doctor will prescribe medicine for them. So this is how the IITians put their mind back and contributed to villages. Not only this one, so many. For want of time, I am not able to list out all their findings, all their research impact that are useful to villagers and other society. So in that way, you must think of the problems existing in the society which are unaddressed, That is very, very important. In that way, NAC is redesigning the key indicators and other indicators so that all the academic institutions will develop a kind of intuition and inclination and curiosity so that they would be able to address the social issues. So this is very important. Friend, now I would like to present the global expenditure on R&D. You see, United States, $581 billion they invest for research and development. You see, China, a most populated country, which is investing almost $520 billion per year. And India is investing $94 billion. So this is how I would like to, and what kind of impact that we create through our research. You see, even China is able to contribute almost 21% to global citation index. Global sharing index. They are able to contribute 21% in terms of their research initiatives, in terms of research publication, in terms of patenting, in terms of IPR, intellectual property rights, in terms of research books, book writing, in terms of knowledge partnership, research partnership. China, the neighboring country, is able to contribute 21%, whereas India is able to contribute only 5% to global citation index or global sharing of research. So we have to improve. We have to compete. Although we are in the third place, but still we have got to improve. We should not be happy with our performance, because we should stand first, for which academia has to play a pivotal role. Academia is an important role. See, that is the reason why we wanted to establish academia industry cluster. But I am sorry to tell you, most of the industries in this part of the country are fed up with the academia research. Research being carried out in academia. That is why all the industry, you know, they want to start their own university. Reliance, they wanted to own Azim Premji University. In that way, Sivanadar University. Why these private institutions, you know, sometime, you know, the industry start their own institution. Sometime I have my own apprehension that the academia is not able to rise up to their expectation, or academia is not able to win the confidence of industry. So in that way, this is one gap we feel, we identify. Therefore, it is very important that through our research initiatives, we have to address the global citation index. We have to stand first. That's very important. Now, you friends, as I have rightly pointed out, the IPR, intellectual property rights, patents, global standardization of efforts, interaction between academia and industry cluster, number of Indian product companies, we have to improve. You see, total number of patents filed in 2017. Look at China, more than 1 lakh. Look at India, you are not able to see. Look at US. And you see, China was able to outperform US, outperform Japan, Germany. So therefore, this must be taken cognition. Filed patents is very important. You see, in that way, NEEM. So many things, you know, are patented by USA. So this is one part that we'll have to concentrate. I don't say that we don't have adequate potential. We have more potential than any other country like China or US or Japan. But only thing is we have to channelize our effort. This is a high time for all of us to take it into account. We have to improve our current state of innovation. And we have to bring about good interface between IPR patents, our academy industry cluster, our standardization effort, and product companies. Number of Indian product companies is very important. If you don't take care of a number of Indian product companies, then you have to invest your money in foreign countries and foreign product companies. So that should not happen. Therefore, we have to improve our innovative thinking. That's very important. Friends, I think two very good speakers you have already come across, Professor Patil and Professor Amiya. You see, they have given you a lot of insights, okay, about the revised accreditation framework. To reiterate, I would like to supplement some of my ideas which would really reinforce you. You see, system-generated grade of higher education institution, you are all aware in the revised accreditation framework, to ensure objective assessment. Now, everybody appreciate revised accreditation framework because this framework will do justice to your higher education institution. And it will be able to get rid of subjective bias. So objective assessment is very much feasible through revised accreditation framework. You see, you get inputs from qualitative metrics using peer judgment for about 25 to 35% depending on the institution, university or autonomous institution or affiliated institution or constituent college, something like that. And you also get input from quantitative metrics, qualitative metrics and quantitative metrics using computer generated score. For about 65 to 70% or 75% computer generated score. So you can't blame the system now. If you exhibit your potential, if you do good to your institution, if you do good to your society at local level, national level, and international level, that will tell upon your accreditation. That will tell upon your assessment. So you cannot afford to blame the system. The system is very good. So you get input from both the judgment. You know, you get input as qualitative metrics and quantitative metrics. Then your grade is taken care of. Friends, you see the stakeholder focus, because any institution must be able to win the confidence of their stakeholders, because we are running the institution for stakeholders. Normally, I used to say, if there are no students, there is no institution. If there are no students, the institutions will not exist. If there are no stakeholders, the institution, educational institutions will not exist. So, institution exists only for the students or the stakeholders. So you must understand stakeholder focus. Therefore, whenever you take initiatives in research, your initiative must cater to the needs of your stakeholder, or you have to satisfy your stakeholders in terms of your initiatives, whether it is teaching learning, whether it is evaluation or curricular aspects or infrastructure or support services, our best practices, innovations, consultancy, anything must help you to satisfy your stakeholders, which is very important. Please have it in your mind. Whatever you initiate, it must help your stakeholders. It must satisfy your stakeholders. That is how NAC assesses you. That is how NAC wants to accredit you. I mean you, in the sense your institution. So look at the input now: students, curricula, faculty, staff, whether you have qualified staff, whether you have the curricula which could help the students to meet up their demands, non-teaching staff, your facilities, infrastructure, your instructional resources or teaching resources. So these inputs, okay, are very important. Look at the process now. You have got to process your teaching, your learning process, staff development, capacity building development, student support and evaluation, research, administration. This must be a process. What is the output? What is the output? Output of any teaching learning process is student achievement. You know, you student achievement, stakeholder achievement. Stakeholder achievement will be the output of any teaching learning process. So how do you demarcate stakeholder achievement? Whether you have given inputs, whether you have processed the inputs for skill development of the students, employable skills, whether you have given employable attributes, graduate attributes to help them have mastery over graduate attributes, whether your students are skillful, whether your research and publications have good output. What would be the output of your research and publications? Whether they have created social impact, or your institution is identified for particular research area. For example, Bharathidasan University is identified for linear dynamics. Something like, you see Harvard, when I spell out Harvard School, immediately you remember Harvard Business School because it is identified by Business School. So in that way, every institution must be identified with some research potential, which is very important, which is the need of the hour. Every institution must be identified by the research idea, a research area, which is very important. And contribution to community in terms of consultancy, in terms of your innovation, in terms of your incubation, in terms of your contribution. So what kind of contribution you have done to at local level, at state level and national level. So this have to be the outputs, so that you would be able to, now your entire process, I mean the process of academic institution, is set to help the stakeholders. So this is how all your initiatives, not only in third criteria, every criteria must concentrate the stakeholder satisfaction. That is why I am presenting this particular slide to you. So whatever the criteria, whatever the initiatives you take in terms of teaching or learning or research or student support services or infrastructure or IQAC or innovation consultancy, your MOU, whatever it may be, it must focus stakeholder satisfaction, which is very important. That is how NAC will assess you. I would like to have a quick, because already you have been given, but still I would like to reinforce you, because NAC accreditation is mandatory for all higher education institutions. So the changes introduced in revised accreditation framework. So previously, I don't want to take much time because two speakers would have given a lot of insights, but still, you see the letter of intent and institutional eligibility for quality assessment, previously old criteria. Now you've got IIQA, India Institutional Quality Assurance now. Now you have window system. Previously it was not the case, now you have got window system. Now you see, only seventh criteria there was a bit modification, but the nomenclature of criteria 3 and 7 has been changed. Previously you have got only 32 key indicators, now 34 for university, 34 for autonomous colleges and 32 for other affiliated colleges. More than 300 questions and 32 key aspects Now more than 130 plus matrices. You have previously question and answer. Now you have got qualitative metrics and quantitative metrics. Qualitative metrics and quantitative metrics. You have pre-qualifying as IEQA, institutional eligibility for quality assessment. But now you have quantitative metrics. 30% as pre-qualifier, you know, DVB. Previously, hard copy of submission of SSR as hard copies. Now you have online submission. Previously, you got evaluative report of department for the colleges. No evaluative report department and report of department for the department and for the colleges. Previously, no data validation and verification. Now you have third party data validation and verification. Previously, student feedback taken at institution level. Now online student satisfaction survey you have. Previously score sheet with 7 criteria, 32 key indicators. Now you have only qualitative metrics score sheet. You have got 38 metrics for university, 38 metrics for autonomous colleges, and 41 metrics for affiliated colleges. So your NAC peer team will come down to peruse only qualitative metrics. But qualitative metrics are very much depending upon your quantitative metrics. But they will assess, they will come down to you to assess only qualitative metrics, because already quantitative metrics has been assessed by the machine generated score. Therefore, only qualitative metrics they come down to assess you. Previously, on-site visit 2 to 5 number of persons. Now only 3 for colleges and 5 maximum for the universities. Previously, 3 to 4 days, 6 days sometimes. Now only 3 days for university and 2 days for colleges. Fully depend on peer review. Previously, peer team had to shoulder the responsibility. But now it is not the case. 70% quantitative metrics and 30%. Previously no grade qualifier and fee. Now grade qualifier fee, A, B, C, something like. Fee structure enhanced now. So these are the things, okay. Previously there is no penalty, but now penalty classes are there for fraudulent data. Your publication, your research initiatives, if anything is found, okay, if NAC finds fault with you, then you will be penalized. The particular institution will be penalized. Okay, that is the class. Okay, they have introduced right now. Now I would like to enter into the distribution of weightage in criteria 3. You see, for university 250 points, autonomous colleges 150, affiliated colleges UG, which offer only UG programs 110. Affiliated colleges which offer PG program 120 points. The weightage is 120 as far as the third criteria, research, innovation and extension, is concerned. And now you see, I would like to give away the key indicators. You know, 7 indicators: promotion of research and facilities, research resource mobilization for research, innovation ecosystem, research publication and awards, consultancy, extension activities and collaboration. This is for university and autonomous colleges. For affiliated colleges, you don't have the first one, promotion of research and facilities, and you don't have the fifth one. It is not applicable. First one is not applicable and fifth one is not applicable. Consultancy, promotion of research and facilities, these both criteria are not applicable for affiliated colleges. And all other 5 criteria, rest of the 5 criteria, are applicable for even constituent colleges and affiliated colleges which offer UG and PG programs. And the distribution of weightage for university autonomous colleges is given in the slide. Now you see the weightage of qualitative and quantitative metrics. You see, for university, 74.7% almost goes to some weightage given to quantitative metrics, and qualitative metrics, you see 25.3%. For autonomous colleges, 69.80%. And for quantitative metrics and qualitative metrics, you see 30.2%. For other affiliated colleges, you know, for 65.2%, especially the third criteria, I'm talking about third criteria, 65.20%, 20.2% for quantitative metrics, and qualitative metrics is 34.8%. Now, I would like to enter into the criteria one. You see 3.1, promotion of research and facilities. So promotion of research and facilities, under this key indicator, now you have couple of other sub-indicators. Well-defined policy for promotion of research. So well-defined policy for promotion of research in the sense, how do you promote research in your campus? How do you promote your teachers and students in research initiatives? In some of the institutions, they provide seed money, and some of the institutions, they provide vacation leave for teachers, research vacation leave. In that way, you can promote. In some of the colleges, I see if you publish one article in high profile journal, journal of repute, or journal of, you know, like Nature, a very famous Photon, Neuron. If you publish your article, one article, you will be given some quantum of money. I remember, I don't want to name the college. If they publish one article in Nature journal, the particular teacher or student will be given 1 lakh rupees. 1 lakh rupees for publishing one article. So now, you know, everybody is motivated. So they are motivated, in fact, and they are able to say, in some institution, if they publish articles in high profile journal, they will be certified. They will be given certification. And that certification will be taken into account for their promotion. So likewise, and in some institution, they institute award, best researcher award. The college or university itself give away awards, best researcher award, and that will be taken into account for their promotion. So this is how they have some well-defined policy. Even I was the expert committee member in one of the universities, Alappa University, Karaikudi in Tamil Nadu. If you publish, publish a high impact journals which improves your H index, then that will be considered for research award, Alappa University Research Award. So likewise, they have number of policy initiatives to promote research. As I told you, it is need of the hour now. Every academia has to contribute. Therefore, whether you have well-defined policy for promotion of research. Sorry. Excuse me. Now, kindly excuse me for a second. Now, I would like to suggest all the principals and IQSE coordinators, you have to benchmark your institution with the other high-profile institutions in India. Not only one India, but also institutions across the country. So that you will be able to identify best practices. So sometime you may not be able to have best practices. If you look at other institutions, so we must learn to appreciate other institutions. And this is like give and take policy. This is called a knowledge partnership. We call knowledge partnership. This is called intellectual honesty. Suppose if Khalsa College of Education has got a best practice, it should not be confined within Khalsa College of Education. But particular college of education has to upload it in the website. You put it in the website, your best practices, so that it will be made available to the population. I mean made available to other academics across the country. So in that way, we have to share our ideas. We should, that is called collaboration. We have to collaborate our ideas. We have to have intellectual honesty so that we help other institutions to promote, other institutions to come up, bring up. It will help other institutions to come up, flying color. That is called Paramarsh. No, Paramarsh means what? Paramarsh scheme. You know, GHC Khalsa College of Education is identified as Paramarsh scheme. So Paramarsh schemes means what? You have to share your best practices with other institutions. This is very important. This is another policy that you have to have. So therefore, if you look at the institutions of high profile across the globe, not only in India, you can even look at IIT, Premier Institute, IIT, IISc, Indian Institute of Science, IIM, ICER, NIT, University of Hyderabad, Jadhpur University, so Punjab University. So likewise, Gurukshetra University. So likewise, you see, you have got number of high profile institutions in this part of the country. You can benchmark, okay, your exercise. If you just peruse their best practices, you would be able to understand the feasibility of those best practices so that you would be able to implement the best practices in your country, in your academic institution, your college or university. In that way, well-defined policy for promotion of research. What kind of policies you have right now to promote and what kind of impact it has created? What is its outcome is very important. It must be outcome-based. So policy is good. Sometime, I'm sorry to say, most of the universities have signed MOU, Memorandum of Understanding, with a number of institutions. But most of their MOUs are not functional. Now and then, you know, they just conduct some initiative. They have some exchange program, student exchange program or teacher exchange program. But what kind of social impact it has created, the MOUs have created, which is very important. So in that way, what kind of policies you have for promotion of research? So do benchmark, have a benchmark exercise. You must be benchmarking, not only in India, other countries abroad. Now you see, gone are those days we were prevented touching upon internet. Now it is not the case. Everything is transparent. Every administration is transparent. You can understand what is happening in Oxford University or Cambridge University or University of Washington or Stanford University or Illinois University, any university for that matter. So what is wrong in going through their initiatives? They can also take good initiatives from us. We can also take good initiatives from them. What is wrong in it? Only thing is, our institution must be benefited. Our society must be benefited in that way, whether you have well-defined policy for promotion of research. The second is seed money, whether the institution instituted a kind of seed money for the faculty members and students, research scholars, to take research initiatives which could address the problems of a particular institution. I don't want to name one university. That university invest quite a good money as seed money for research scholars, postdoctoral fellowship scholars, faculty, young faculty members, for writing proposals which could address the problems in the university, particular university. The university comes out with a number of problems. Now they have to address the problems in terms of their research intelligentsia. And the money is extended to them by the university. This is the best practice. Now they don't have to ask anybody to solve their problems. Their problems are solved by themselves. This is a best practice. So they offer seed money to research scholars and young faculty members, and they come forward to solve the problems encountered by themselves. So whether you offer any seed money, what kind of impact it has created? Then number of teachers awarded international fellowship. See, number of international, Even you see UK Japan Fellowship, Indo-Japan Fellowship, Indo-French Fellowship. We have DST offers Indo-French Fellowship, the DST Inspire Fellowship. They see Indo-French Fellowship is international fellowship. So you can tap money from other countries. If your ideas are very good, it is a cakewalk for you. If I am not exaggerating, it is a cakewalk for you to tap, mobilize money from international agencies and institutions. And number of chair of junior research fellowship, senior research fellowship, postdoctoral fellowship, research associates and other research fellowship. So you have to create awareness in your students. That's very important. Had NAC not taken initiatives, redesigned the criteria, sometime most of the academic institutions are in dark and they may not expose these ideas to their students. So you have to give them exposure about JIR. Perhaps the curriculum must be part and parcel. You know, the curriculum should incorporate ideas and thoughts and contents relevant to JRF, SRF and postdoctoral fellowship. What is wrong? So in that way, number of JRF junior research fellowship and senior research fellowship, postdoctoral fellowship, research associate and other research fellows. This is very important for promotion of research. These are the key indicators to address 3.1, promotion of research and facilities. You see the second one, resource mobilization for research. This is the another key indicator of criteria 3. You see a couple of indicators, sub-indicators you have. That is grants for research projects sponsored by government and non-government sources. And I would like to suggest some of my ideas. Most out of my little observation and experience is concerned, most of the academic institutions are always interested in tapping public money, money from UGC, money from DST, DBT, or ministries, or AICT. It is good. I appreciate you. Why can't you think of tapping public private money, private funding? I would say every industry has got CSR, corporate social responsibility. Every industry is inclined to institute CSR fellowship, corporate social responsibility. So in that way, you can tap public, private money also, private funding. I still remember my university recently, last year, mobilized for about 1 crore from BHEL, Bharat Heavy Electrical Limited. In that way, we are able to penetrate the rural population of India. And we were able to research their sanitation, women sanitation. So women hygiene and sanitation. And we were able to throw some initiatives for them to help. We provided incinerators for rural areas and rural schools. In that way, the society got benefited out of it. So in that way, you can think of tapping private funding also through CSR scheme, corporate social responsibility. Not only in India, you can even tap private funding from other countries. I would like to give you Melinda Gates Foundation. You know, Bill Gates' wife foundation, Melinda Gates Foundation. They have got a beautiful finance. They invite researchers across the globe. They are ready to fund crores and crores of billions and billions of dollars. Only thing is, you have got to develop e-resources so that the rural population, rural economy will be benefited. So this is the very noble initiatives instituted by Melinda Gates Foundation, not only in Melinda Gates, even Tata. So likewise, you have to think of tapping money, tapping fund from private funding. I am so happy that you are tapping, you are mobilizing money in terms of your research projects from public institutions. Why don't you think of tapping money from private institution, private industry, so that this is very important. This will be the important main focus of NAC. And you see the second one, number of research projects per teacher. Every teacher must be motivated to take a project, either minor research project or major research project. You keep writing proposals. If you don't get today, I think you'll have to understand the gray area that you have to improve upon. Now your research proposal is not able to win the confidence of the particular funding agency. Now you have got to improve. So you have to improve writing your proposal. You should not be fed up at any cost. You should not be frustrated. So you identify, you go through your proposal. Then you may try to mitigate the problems you come across. So in that way, you have to read a lot of articles, research, and you have to penetrate the society. What are their problems now? What is my confidence? What is my intelligence here to address their problems? Which is very important. Therefore, every teacher must be promoted. But whenever I go to the institutions, they call themselves associate professor and professors. They have not taken even single project I have come across. So this is very bad. Every teacher has to take up at least one minor or major, not only one, please don't be under the impression. You have to take one, at least one major or minor research project. Once you take up projects, now you will be motivated. And you will be motivated. So why we are not, sometimes we are lackadaisical. We are lackadaisical writing proposals because we are unaware of the problems of society. We are not aware of the problems of the society. Once you start getting aware of the problems of the society, you will be interested, you will be motivated to write more, many number of proposals to many funding agencies. This is very important. A number of full-time teachers worked in your institutions. That's very important. Now, as far as UGC guidelines is concerned, universities should not appoint guest faculty teachers. They have to appoint only full-time teachers. In that way, NAC is very conscious. NAC is very keen whether you have appointed full-time teachers working in the institution, which is very important. You see, the third key indicator of 3.3, indicator of research, innovation and extension, innovation ecosystem. So you have to create innovation ecosystem in terms of your research. How do you create innovation ecosystem? Who is more important? So whenever you say innovation ecosystem, now the entrepreneur and industry have to play a vital role now. So now the entrepreneur will take the ideas from you and they will go to the industry and the industry will give you the product. Academia will take up research, and through research, the entrepreneur will take the idea, the outcome of the research to the industry, and the industry will give away the product you want. I mean the society wants. So this is called the innovation ecosystem. So the innovation ecosystem, academia initiates research of social impact and entrepreneurs gets the outcomes of research and entrepreneur gets it and provides it to the industry and industry will evolve a product the society wants. So therefore, you need to have the triangulation, academia, entrepreneur and industry. So you have to create a good interaction among academic institutions, entrepreneurs and so that and industry. For example, startup. What kind of startup? I am going to give you anyhow. Incubation in the sense startup. Because startup is the integral part of our Indian economy. So what is our position now? We are in the third position, I guess, as far as startup is concerned. We are really flourishing. We are really working very well in creating startups now. So incubation, innovation ecosystem is very important. In that way, the first determinant says whether institution has created an ecosystem for innovations, including incubation center and other initiatives for creation and transfer of knowledge. What kind of incubation center you have created? Yes, your research must, as I rightly pointed out, your research must help you to solve your problems. So you must have an innovation center, incubation center. Now you see, incubation center, once you create, you can give placement for your children. I am the director of DD Kausal Kendra. We have got incubation center now. We are offering 3 trade roles: automobile technology, troubleshooting maintenance of electrical and electronic equipments, and logistics and supply chain management. Some of the industry came down to house in our campus, and our students are given internship in the industries. If our students are able to do well, now they absorb our students. So our students get placement because we have created incubation center. In that way, we have got Bharathidasan University Technology Park. Our own students, MCA students, established their companies and they provide solution to the third parties. They provide solution to the third parties, and through their consultancy, they make money and they provide money to the university. So therefore, a concept of incubation center, so that your institution will be self-reliant. You should not expect only UGC has to give you money, all money that you want. You develop incubation center, you develop entrepreneurship and career development so that you can be self-reliant. Your institution can be self-reliant. That is the idea of NAC, which has redesigned this criteria. Therefore, incubation center and other initiatives for creation and transfer of knowledge is very important. Because many knowledge that we provide them go waste, go in vain. They learn lot of ideas, but they are not able to come out with a new product, prototype. So your student must create prototype. They learn science, they learn humanities, they learn psychology, they learn paramedical courses. What prototype they have created out of their research, which is very important. So if you understand the concept of incubation center, you can give lot of prototype, which will in turn throw products which are useful to the society, which is very important. And number of workshops and seminars conducted on IPR, intellectual property rights, because you have to conduct capacity buildings for your students, researchers, and faculty members even. You must be aware of intellectual property rights. How can I file the patent? What are all the formalities, prerequisites I have to go through? The prerequisites and formalities I have to fulfill so that I can file patent. I can have intellectual property rights. Very important. Even in education college, you have copyright. The concept of for arts copyright, for science patents, for arts copyrights. You can standardize your tool and get copyrights. That will bring visibility to your institution. Now visibility is more important. If every institution brings visibility, international visibility, then you can attract students from other countries. Students from Pakistan or other countries will come down to Punjab, GLC Khalsa of Education, because they've got lot of copyrights. So Dr. Manu, the IQSC coordinator, has to take cognizance. So therefore, you can think of producing copyrights is very important. And number of workshops and seminars on capacity buildings that you organize, so that you can make them discuss, share their ideas of industry academia clusters, and they can come out with innovative practices. So how many of you, how many of such capacity buildings you have organized? That is what NAC wants. So the revised accreditation framework is wonderful. It's very genuine. You know, very genuine effort they have taken, because all the great academicians and administrators benchmarked, put their mind back, and they have redesigned the revised accreditation framework. So therefore, it is a very good teamwork. Now they have all shared their intelligentsia, and we have got a beautiful system now. So therefore, you have to rise up to the expectations of NAC. Friends, another key indicators, the sub-indicators, number of awards for innovation won by institutions, teachers, research scholars. So many awards. You know, UGC has instituted number of awards. DST Inspire Fellowship you have. Then Young Researcher Award. You have got Young Researcher Award. Okay. Excuse me. So you have got Young Researcher Award. You know, so many awards are there. You can just think of, you know, getting these awards for innovation. You know, you have to participate. You have to motivate your researchers to participate. For example, you know, especially IITs, they conduct a hackathon. So many events they conduct on artificial intelligence, augmented reality, virtual reality. So this is the need of the hour right now. You've got IoT, data science, Internet of Things, data science, IoT in medicine, IoT in architecture, IoT in construction. So likewise, you identify your potential and you have to motivate your teachers and students, researchers, participate in these initiatives so that they will be able to pack a lot of awards for you. So how many awards that your institution? Participation is very important. And number of startups incubated on campus during the last 5 years, your academic, these are all must happen your assessment period for the past 5 years, which I have not told you, but I am reiterating right now. So number of startups incubated is very important. At least one startup, one institution, one startup, the NAC will appreciate you. So NAC is not the fault-finding team. NAC is fact-finding team. And NAC, you know, comes down to you. NAC peer team come down to you. I think the good experience the Khalsa College of Education had a couple of years back. So NAC peer team comes down to your campus as a fact-finding team, and it will spot out your strengths and weaknesses. I don't say weaknesses. It will spot out the areas you have to improve upon. So therefore, it is a very good, wonderful academic exercise. NAC is a wonderful academic exercise. One can really cherish. Only thing is, systematically, if you understand, if you document it, it is a cakewalk for you. It is not a difficult task. It is not a tedious task. It's a very, very easy task. But the IQAC has to really put their mind back. And it has to put in its hard work, and it has to have its preparedness and readiness so that it can make NAC accreditation a cakewalk. See, number of startups incubated on campus during last 5 years, it's very important. At least one startup, especially science faculties, you can have one startup, okay? You can attract one company to house in your institution. I will be happy. So in that way, you have to win the confidence of NAC. Friends, the next research publication and awards is a fourth criteria. State Code of Ethics. Do you have any State Code of Ethics for preventing plagiarism in your research? You know, UGC has circulated a software free of cost, Urkund. You know Urkund? Urkund software. Now it is made compulsory for PhD research. For any publication, now you cannot involve in malpractices or plagiarism. Why? Because any high profile journal, they have got beautiful system, authenticate like Urkund, which is little expensive, but if you want to buy, you can buy it. You can purchase it. Nothing wrong in it. If you can afford, you can buy, purchase this software, Authenticate, which is very objective, very valid and reliable instrument, a software which can assess you how much percentage of plagiarism you have. So likewise, do you have any code of ethics in your system? NAC wants to pursue. And other thing is provision of incentives to teachers who receive state, national and international recognition, honors and awards. This is very important. Incentive is very important. Not only monetary incentive. Excuse me. Not only monetary incentive, some motivating incentives. You give away a certificate to them, you appreciate them in the assembly. And you when I was a registrar, I used to do, when they publish their articles, I put it in the vice chancellor chamber and registrar chamber so that the professor will get motivated. Come on, I get my identities. I have to put in my hard work. So likewise, you have to identify some best practices. So institute some incentives. Do you have any incentives to teachers who... Incentives does not mean that monetary incentives. Any incentives. Receive state, national and international recognition, honors and awards. A number of patents published, filed, awarded during the assessment period. Number of PhDs awarded per teacher. And next thing is... research publication award, number of research paper per teacher. You have to motivate them, publish in high profile journal, affiliated to Scopus, PubMed, Clarivate, Web of Science, Web of Knowledge. You have to conduct capacity building for them, how to write a research proposal, how to publish your thoughts in top level journals. Conduct capacity building programs. If you give them awareness, they will be good. They are growing in research, quality research. So this is very important. A number of books and chapters in edited volumes, books published, everything must be documented because you have got both qualitative metrics and quantitative metrics. Similarly, you have got bibliometrics of publications in Indian Citation Index and PubMed, as I told you, Web of Science, Scopus. And then bibliometric publication is H Index. So H index and other citation index, which are very important. So this is how research publication and art. But I would like to suggest you help encourage your teachers to publish their ideas, having the philosophy, publish or perish. Let them identify the problems which exist in the society. Then let them put out their research, which will be of great helpful to the society. This is very important. Let them not publish their articles for sake of publishing, which is very, very important. This is not for this. NAC is not at it. You know, that is why NAC says, in terms of initiatives, research initiatives, what kind of social impact the academic institution has created. This is very, very important. And if you do it, what happened? You would be able to attract students from other countries. There is no doubt. That is the reason some private universities, I don't want to name them, they are able to attract students from many countries, 15 countries, 20 countries. In Maharashtra, I had been to one private university, UGC organized a seminar, and I saw students from 20 countries. So they are able to, you know, address the economy of India. See, in that way, you have to think of, every institution has to think of attracting students from other country, showcasing your research potential. That's very important. Showcasing your research potential. So you have to showcase your research potential. You have to prove yourself. And every institution must have a proven record. That is also very important. Friends, the next 3.5, consultancy. See, whether you have policy and consultancy, including revenue sharing, is very important. Whenever I go to NAC visit for a couple of institutions, they say they come out with some consultancies where they have not generated any revenues. They offer free consultancy, but which may not be taken into account. It is good. Perhaps you bring your institution into visibility, but here revenue sharing is very important through your consultancy. For example, if you are an expert of biotechnology, there is a concept of spirulina. So you can develop a spirulina concept, and you can even manufacture spirulina products. You sell it out, and you provide consultancy for young entrepreneurs and the rural folk, rural women. You develop, you get some consultancy. See, this is one example I am giving. If you ask me to give example, I can give many examples. But for want of time, one or two examples I am throwing. Then revenue generated from consultancy is very important. Revenue generated from corporate training. Sometime you offer your management department. You offer BBA, MBA. You have got management department. Some of your teachers are corporate trainers. They will train, corporates. Your language teacher will train some corporates. So from training them, you can generate money. There are so many avenues you have to mobilize revenues. Avenues to mobilize revenues is very important. In that way, the consultancy must be taken into account. Then extension activities. Very important thing is extension activities. The philosophy is lab to land. LL, lab to land. What you do in the lab must go to the land. What you do in the lab must go to the society is very important. All your researches are confined only in lab. No use, it is there of no use. So your researches must embrace a philosophy called lab to land. Lab to land is very important. That is how extension activities must be designed. Not only lab to land, sometime you have, especially Punjab, every Indian has to salute Punjabians, because you see, they contribute their human resources to military, naval academy, even navy and the air force. In that way, you have to encourage your children, your students to participate in national issues, national agendas like NSS, NCC, Red Ribbon Club, ORC, Youth Red Cross. Likewise, you have to participate in extension activities. So extension activities in neighborhood community in terms of impact, sensitizing students to social issues and holistic development. You have to sensitize. Sometime you can adopt a village. They have got a lot of problems, women sanitation, village sanitation, women hygiene. So rural villages, they are not aware of women hygiene. They are really dying without knowing women hygiene. They don't know how to use pads and napkins. I'm sorry to say. So in that way, you have to really adopt a village, or you have to render your services to village, so that you are able to address the social issues. That's very important. Number of awards and recognition received for extension services. Recently, our university was awarded by a president of India the best national service scheme coordinator award, best NSS coordinator award, best NSS scheme award. Our vice chancellor, received the award from the president of India. So in that way, you have to think, because the blood donors, more than 10 lakh people, they have get blood donation, involved for blood donations, blood donation camps, organized by our university. In that way, you have to see the award we got it. Likewise, I went through, I think GSC, Khalsa College of Education and Arts and Science College, they got number of awards. Likewise, the best institutions you will have to go through. Then you will grow through. So you go through the best institution, grow through your extension activities in that way. So number of awards and recognition received for extension activities from government and recognized bodies. Not only from government, NGOs even. And see, number of extension and outreach programs conducted in collaboration with industry, community and non-government organization through NSS, NCC, Red Cross, Y-Cross, etc., YRC, etc. That's what. So percentage of students and non-participating in extension activities with government organization, NGOs, programs such as Swachh Bharat, AIDS awareness, gender issue, etc. Because, you know, with a lot of good intentions, Government of India, especially our Prime Minister G, has launched a lot of good initiatives. And we have to create awareness in our students. And we have to encourage, motivate our students to participate in it. After all, our premises get benefited, our society get benefited, and by and large, our country get benefited out of it. So in that way, the percentage of students you encourage is very important. And you see, last key indicator, collaboration. But I would like to, before I get into it, look at the concept. Collaborate, coexist, conquer. So today's fact, the R&D, research and development, you know, expenses and risk innovation are at high, most innovation, industrial revolutions, okay? You have to see, you have to look at, so that you will get a lot of best practices. You see the incremental innovations versus original invention. We need original inventions. Incremental innovations we have to get, we have to understand. And original invention, we have to have original inventions. Why should we get it from other countries? Why should we import technologies from other country, apparatus from other countries? Let us create. We have enough potential to create. Let us make our country self-reliant. We have, let us have startups in terms of collaborating. Let us create an Indian ecosystem and international ecosystem. Let us encourage ourselves, our faculty members to have startups to solve problems of industry. That's very important. We have to address the problems of industry also through researches. So NAC is very bothered about it. NAC is very conscious about it. So in that way, giving these inputs, I go to the 3.7 collaboration. You see the key indicators, collaboration. Number of, you see, now collaboration is easily possible, if I am not exaggerating, because you have got leverage technologies, modern technologies. You leverage technology, through leveraging technologies, you can contact anybody, you can contact any high profile institution, you can contact any high profile human resources in this world, and you can collaborate with themselves. They are all so honest. They are all having intellectual honesty. And they come forward to collaborate with you. They share, they have their knowledge partnership with you. You can easily collaborate with them. So collaboration is easy right now. It is not a tedious process. It is not a laborious process. It is very, very easiest process, very easy process. So in that way, number of linkages for faculty exchange, student exchange, internship, field trip, job training, research is very important. So you send your students, you know, because your students have to win the confidence of job providers, industry, institutions. Sometimes they get gold medal, but they are not able to answer the questions raised by industry or job providers. I have been in selection committee, number of selection committee, number of institution and industry. When we raise the question, you know, even gold medalist was not able to rise up to our expectations. So therefore, you must think of, you know, creating linkages for faculty exchange. You go to industry. You see, IIT, that's what they do. Faculty members go to industry, work for 1 year or 2 years. They understand the problems of industry. They come back to the institution and teach the students. Industry people, industrialists, you know, industry people come down to IIT campus. They learn teaching how to, and they understand the expectations of the students. They provide, they upskill students in terms of their requirements. So beautiful exchange happens in IIT. I had been to IIT Mumbai, marvelous. Please visit IIT, higher premier. No higher institution in this world can compete with IIT, if I'm not mistaken. So beautiful exchange happens there. Industry people come down to institution, they start teaching. They upskill students the way they want. Academicians, professors go to industry for 2 years. They work in industries so that they understand the problems of industries. They come and share their ideas with the students. And now all the students are industry ready. Every student is placed across the world, not only in India, across the world they are placed. Beautiful practice, best practice happens. Likewise, you can think of promoting best practice for job training.
things like that. And number of functional area MOU is very important. I have already pointed out. I have already insisted also. I was very assertive. NAC is very assertive. Whether your MOUs are functional. You should not be signing MOU just for sake of signing. You wanted to show, you want to showcase MOU in front of NAC. No, functional MOU. That is why it is asking you how many programs you have organized. And socially impact program. How many people get benefited out of it? Do your MOUs penetrate through social issues? How many of your students get benefited out of it? So many things have to be taken into account. In that way, if you move up, you know, I think you will be able to win the confidence of NAC in terms of your research, innovation, and extension. And I wish all the institutions best. I wish them all the best that all the institution must get a higher grade. You know, you have to get A plus. 40,000 institutions, higher education colleges we have. 992 universities we have. But I'm very unfortunate to tell you, only 11 universities have been accredited with A plus. Only 4 universities were accredited with A++. 992 universities we have. Only 4 universities were accredited with A++ and 11 universities with A+. And our university was accredited with A+, I'm happy to say. So it does not mean, see, I think all the universities take a lot of initiative. And you know, UGC has NAC and UGC along with UGC have thrown a beautiful initiative called Paramarsh. Through Paramarsh, you know, you will get a lot of insights. I hope every institution, higher education institution in India will be accredited A and above. I wish you all the best. Thank you very much for the opportunity extended to me. Thank you very much for your sparing time, your lending your ears to me for a couple of hours. Thank you very much. Now, if you have any questions, you can ask me.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for the wonderful session. So now a few questions. I've been noting down throughout the session. I was noting. So somebody has asked that if a grant has been sanctioned by UGC, but it has not yet been dispersed by UGC. So what do they write? Do they write the amount when they are writing about it? Although it has been sanctioned but not dispersed.
Certainly. See, once it is sanctioned, can I answer the question?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So, Dr. Manu. See, once it is approved, sanctioned, definitely it will be released. You see, the one of the policies, SOP, you can find out, till it approved, you can start, you can ignite your doing projects with the money, allotted by your institution or your university. Hope you understand. Yes. Till they release money, the particular institution can release money, some money for the researcher to ignite their project. Nothing wrong with it. Because once it is approved, I guarantee that it will be released. Only matter of time. Because they have got largest higher education system. We have got 40,000 institutions. Okay. Therefore, you don't have to develop any apprehension. Once it is sanctioned, it will be released. Because I was also a part of the expert committee member in UGC for assessing a major research projects. So once it is approved, allotted for you, sanctioned for you, it will be released. In the meantime, the institution has to spare the money.
Okay. Irrespective of the time. I mean, you can take any...
You should not wait for UGC to, you know, allot money. Okay, sometime they will give you some... after 2 months or 3 months, but you don't have to wait. You immediately ignite your initiative.
So, but with your policies, like I myself has been, the grant has been sanctioned, but it's almost 4 to 5 years. Same as with Dr. Pivot.
If you don't get it, so please communicate with the particular sections. Communicate with the joint secretary.
Okay.
So now you see, they are all very approachable. I tell you, I don't want to name them. If you ask me, I can even name them, but it is not good on my part naming them, because you see, some officers are very good intention to help us. Only thing is, you know, we have to, because we have been sanctioned a project, and we have to be aware of, you know, knocking at their door. Okay. So therefore, you knock at the door, you will be given unto you. Okay. So you contact the joint secretary or a special officer.
Okay.
Don't contact anybody.
Okay, sir.
For anything, contact joint secretary or
special officer.
Special officer through email.
Okay.
You don't have to go come down to UGC. Perhaps you can just contact them through email.
Okay. So related to this only, somebody had asked, could you name some non-government agencies for grants?
Yeah, that's what I told you. See, non-NGOs, many NGOs are there. How can I? You see, industry, you tap money from industry. That is CSR, through CSR, corporate social responsibility. Every industry must have corporate social responsibility. If you ask me to list out, I can give you thousands and thousands. You see, you can go to Tata and so industry, you know, high energy battery, TVS, you know, so many industries are there. So neighboring industries, you have to find out and you showcase your research potential. That is very important. They cannot simply sanction money for you. You have to have a proven record. You must have good publications. Okay. You must have all other facilities so that you can easily tap corporate social responsibility, CSR from industries and NGOs. So many NGOs are there.
Right. Then this question is probably from plenty of participants about the incubation center.
Yeah.
They
yeah.
want to know the structure, they want to yeah. know the formalities, and they also yeah. want to know the funding agencies.
Yeah, very good.
That somebody had also asked that since we yeah. are, the college is in the rural area, they are yeah. from the rural background. So starting an incubation center, the yeah. industries do not take much interest in linking with such colleges.
Yeah, very good question.
That and plus there, I'm just combining all of them related to this.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
If it's an arts college, just the arts courses, then how can they start incubation centers? So
yeah.
in other words, they want to just
yeah, very good, very good. See, I think one idea, sometimes, you know, arts and science college get speculated. Sometimes they are skeptical about establishing, you know, incubation center. But still, I would like to give you some, throw some idea. See, if you offer language, you know, language translation, why don't you start up? You know, why don't you have incubation center in language translation? Now you can conduct the capacity building in particular area, soft skills and life skills, corporate training. You know, your arts teachers, you know, and students, you know, you can just put your mind back. You have a capacity building center, incubation center for capacity building in soft skills and life skills. Translation, you know, translating Hindi translation to English or Punjabi translation to English. Likewise, you can have incubation center for translation. Only thing is, you have to showcase your potential. You see, I remember one of the, I don't want to name the college, okay? Because I am going for NAC, I should not appreciate one particular college. One college, you know, they have got incubation center in poetry workshop. You know, they have got a potential in conducting poetry, English poetry. So they will teach you all modalities of organizing a poetry workshop, capacity building, poetry workshop now. So even arts and science, even rural college, there is no divide. Friends, please understand me. There is no divide right now. You don't have rural and urban divide right now. Your college may be located in a rural area. What is wrong in developing incubation? A small incubation. You can even, you know, collaborate with a bicycle company. In a bicycle company, what idea you can give them to give them a product, a small product? You know, welding, even welding, you know, welding, you can do a job work. So why don't you bring an industry so that you can help them to develop, manufacture products there? But the product must be your product. The ideas must be. So you have to only, in the incubation, you have to only provide ideas. You don't have to spare money at all. See, I have doubt, as a director of DD Kausal Kendra in our university, you know, Yamaha industry, instituted and established their incubation center. We have only given space for them. Okay? And they need one product. We give them idea and logistics. That idea they don't have. And the academy provides idea for them. And they develop, they invest money for developing the product. Only we give them prototype. All money is invested by industry. But the industry has to, you know, understand that you have the potential. Industry has to believe in you. Industry must be confident of you that you can do it for them in terms of your ideas. So you are only going to provide ideas in the incubation center. You are not going to invest money. You should not get money from the university and make it. Only industry or NGOs will come down to you. You see, another beautiful thing I will tell you, in Maharashtra, Dapawala, you know, Dapawala is known for for logistics and supply chain management. Exactly. So that idea, if you incubate that idea, I think that is not there in Punjab or Chennai, in Tamil Nadu or Bangalore in Karnataka. Why can't you bring the same idea in Bangalore and Chennai? Or Chandigarh.
So we need to have a formal setup for it.
Yeah, you have to have a formal setup. So you have to create bylaws that must be, you know, approved by your academic council and governing council. That's all.
Academic council of the university.
Yeah, academic council of the institution, autonomous institution.
Okay.
The institution, okay. Governing council of the autonomous institution.
Okay.
Right,
sir. Thank you so much. So there was another question. It is related to 3.3.1. Yeah. They have asked us to, like, URL has to be URL of the research page on a higher education website.
Yeah.
It's supposed to be some dedicated page to be made or just a link to be added?
No. The dedicated page and the link is very important. Retrieved from when, the date, okay. The link. And page is also very important. You see, you have to follow APA, American Psychological Association. This is a bibliometric index.
Yes, sir.
Menle, for science, Menle. So Menle for arts, APA, MLA, Member of Linguistic Organization, Association for Languages. So you have to follow MLA style. So if you go through the style, bibliometrics, you will understand. The cytometrics and bibliometrics, if you go through, according to the expectations, you have to make it.
So related to this only, somebody has asked that UGC, the list of research journals of the UGC, that's quite dynamic. It keeps changing. One month it is there.
That is very important. See, you see, even we have uncertain situation right now. See, we are all learning at home. You are at your home, I am at my home. You know, we are exchanging our ideas. Have you ever thought, you know, we will be able to face uncertain situation, a situation of volatile? So we have got to be resilient. So that is called resilient technologies. So this Zoom is resilient technology. Google Meet is resilient technology. Why? Because we are able to come out of our difficult situations. So you have got to be resilient now. So therefore, nothing will remain constant. You see, when I came down to GSC Khalsa of Education as a NAC peer team chairman, you know, I did not have much gray hair. Now I have gray hair. Okay. Now nothing remains changed. See, if any journal does not, you know, ensure quality, it will be thrown away.
Yes, sir.
If any institution does not ensure quality, it will be thrown away in the days to go. You see, the CEO of Coursera, Mr. Stephen Daban says, he's a CEO of Coursera, he says, after 2050, there will be only 10 higher education institutions in the world. Only 10 universities in the world, he says. There won't be any Bharatiya University or Punjab University or Central University, State University. Only, or any colleges also. You have only 10 higher education institutions. Now we have lakhs and lakhs of institutions. You will have only 10 institutions which will cater to the needs of students across the world. because everything is going to be online learning. That's what he says. The Coursera will be one among 10, he says.
And so there was another question, how to check the impact of qualitative improvement of extension activities?
Very good. It's a good question. How to check? You assess yourself. Does it really create a social impact? That's very important. You see, we do a lot of PhDs. Have the PhD researchers taken to the level of development? No. At least theory development, technology development, strategic development. So it has to ensure. In that way, whatever the research you do, it must make at least a hairline difference. You see the hairline difference. Hair is very thin, no? Hairline difference, and it has to use, it must be useful to the society. So your research must make a hairline difference. That's what make the difference, we say, no? So hairline difference it has to make. So we have to be conscious. We have to be committed. We have to be accountable so that I can assess my research. Am I correct or not? So if you want to win the confidence of NAC, your research must be inclined towards the needs of the society. That's very important.
To cater to the community.
Yeah.
So there's another question that college performs many activities that are actually given by the, like, we every day get something from the PIO or from the government agencies. Yeah. And these activities, I think, are taken as routine activities.
Yeah.
In the template, I think that's 3.4.2, where the template demands that the number of awards and recognitions that have been received through these extension activities. So, sir, what do you suggest, that should we demand these agencies for these recognitions or awards? How to manage with it?
I think audience of high profile. Now we have audience of high profile. Very important question you asked me. You see, now when you think of, you see, for example, when could you just brief the question once again?
Sir, it was that all those activities as
yeah, I understand. Yeah, you see, the items, indicators which are given by NAC are only indicative, they are not exhaustive. So you don't have to follow the routine activities.
Right.
You can be innovative. Innovation is inevitable. You can be more innovative. Am I correct or not? So, whatever you think of the initiatives which could benefit your students and society, you do it. That will be taken cognizance by NAC, even if it is not mentioned in NAC manuals. Even if it is not mentioned in NAC manuals. Suppose, for example, finding a vaccine for coronavirus is not in the NAC manual. If one institution provides a bit of idea, definitely it must be taken into account. It must be honored. It must be awarded. I think you have asked me a very good question. Please don't be under the impression that you have to strictly adhere to the key indicators assigned by, developed by NAC. They are only indicative. You can put your mind back. You can put your thoughts back. You can be innovative. You can come out with your own idea, whatever may be the idea. Don't bother about it. You see, there is one beautiful quote, Alvin Toffler. Yeah, Alvin Toffler, he says, illiterates are not those who cannot read and write. Illiterates are those who cannot learn, relearn, and unlearn. You may be illiterate. You cannot read and write, but still you can be innovative. You know, our former chief minister, Mr. Kamaraj, was illiterate, but he was the effective chief minister. He threw lot of innovative ideas. You know, he constructed 16 dams in Tamil Nadu. None of the other has constructed. Had he not done it, then we would have been in blues. So therefore, you must know to learn, relearn, and unlearn. That's very important. Therefore, any initiatives you think of any initiatives, don't bother. If it benefits your students and society, it will be taken cognizance by NAC.
So there's another question that you said about plagiarism. That yeah. University UGC has given access to Urkund to
yeah.
the But this is not applicable to the colleges. Like we in colleges also, we have internet, but we cannot take access to Urkund because university has appointed a nodal officer. So what to do about it?
Wonderful question. You see, that's why you see, if at all you want to publish your article in high profile journals, top level journals, for example, for education, top level journal, I would say Photon, British Journal of Educational Technology, Australian Journal of Educational Technology. So likewise, number of top level journals which have got high impact factor and H indexes. Citation, you will gain a lot of citation indexes. So if you want to publish your article, now you have to learn authenticate. They use authenticate. If you use Urkund, your paper will not be accepted. Your research article will not be accepted. Therefore, what you can do, I think Dr. Bhargat Singh has to take this point. Perhaps you can get very little money from all the institution in Punjab. And you can buy one software authenticate, which will be uploaded. Okay, you for example, GHC Khalsa of Education is a nodal agency for authenticate. So whoever contributed can send the paper through email to GHC Khalsa College of Education. And they can get the marking, plagiarism percentage. In that way, you can win the confidence of top level journals. This is one idea I am throwing. You can, if you share bit of money, everybody can share bit of money, So you can act as a nodal agency and you can help them. Likewise, another important point I would like to tell you, every institution you establish a research consortium. Have a research consortium. Consortium, GHC College of Education Consortia, Punjab University Research Consortia, Gorakshetra University Research Consortia. Likewise, each and every institution you establish research consortia and you share your ideas. You invite other faculty members to be a member of your consortia so that you can exchange your ideas and you can be a member of other consortia. So that you can exchange your ideas to others. Likewise, you build up your knowledge partnership, research partnership, so that you can just see, you go through foreign journals. If you go through foreign journals, a professor from Harvard University and a professor from University of Geneva, Switzerland, another professor from India, another professor from Pakistan, another professor from five countries, they put their mind back, they collaborated themselves, ideas, exchanged their ideas, they published an article. Therefore, this article, command over publications in top level journals. It earns command over publications in top level journals. But now you see, Khalsa College only, Bharatiya University, only Bharatiya University professor. That is the reason many times we are not able to win the confidence of top level journals. Our global index is very low, only 5%. China does it now. China is able to outperform other countries. Am I correct or not? So you have to think of establishing research consortia. I'm sorry, I have forgotten to tell you, but I think you have reminded me of establish research consortia. In each institute, this will be the best practice. NAC will appreciate you. So start with you develop research consortia in teacher education.
Right.
Okay. And then Dr. Manu, while introducing me, she was pointing out, you develop center for knowledge repository, center for research repository, or center for knowledge repository, where you can exchange your ideas, share your ideas. You can invite other professors from other countries to be a member of knowledge repository.
Cool, sir.
Plenty of things we can do it.
So there's another question by Dr. Mini, that how to go side by side in terms of collaboration, that is sharing innovative practices and intellectual property rights.
Very good question. Very good question. You see, to start with, suppose your college is located in rural area, you collaborate your institution with panchayat agency. Even you have a local panchayat, So start with you collaborate with your local body.
I will be happy. NAC will be happy. As a local academic institution, as a rural academic institution, you collaborate with panchayat body. So likewise, it will, you know, it is not a one day process. So slowly you have to improve. Now you showcase your potential, maybe the state level agency, NGO, national level agency, and then show your publication. Is very, very important. You see, your institution must be identified by your publications. Once you publish in top level journals, now you are on the top of the world, because you are you will be identified by the entire world. Come on, you see, I give you one example. A PhD scholars in a PhD scholar in microbiology department of our university had published one paper in one of the top level journals. He is in the first year, just finished his MSc. Now he is in the first year of research, PhD. That paper attracted a Korean industry. You know, Korean industry phoned to him and offered him job. Then he said he wanted to complete the PhD. No problem. You come down to my industry, we'll give you a job. You do your PhD through part-time basis or in Korea itself. We will spare all money. Now this student is earning more than his guide, Professor Tajuddin. He is a professor and head of the Department of Microbiology. His student is earning more than the professor. It is possible. Because of one publication, he made a difference. He made a difference. He got a job in Korea. See, I tell you, this is how you have to collaborate. Your publication matters. Think of publishing your articles in Scopus Citation Index, Web of Science, Web of Knowledge. Leave alone UGC sometime, if I am not mistaken. UGC should not penalize me. See, UGC journals are, most of the journals are affiliated to Scopus and Web of Science and Web of Knowledge. Clarivate, PubMed. So likewise, you must have high thinking. High thinking in the sense, you see, think of publishing your, only thing is you must have original ideas. You should not manipulate. Am I correct or not?
Yes, sir.
So you can, they will come to collaborate with you. You don't have to collaborate. They will come to collaborate with you. See, IITs, they don't go. All the industries go to, you know, capture IIT, chase IIT for collaboration.
Exactly. Right.
Likewise, you have to improve your collaboration.
To make that position. Yeah. You have to do something so that they come to you.
Yeah, they come to you.
You have to be that innovative and creative. So then somebody has asked that, how can we go for patent of new research?
Yeah, the patent, you say, is very tedious. You have to give me 1 hour. You see, now there are some modalities and prerequisite skills for patent. There are some organizations, okay? So you have to Google out. You see, simply Google out. Learning by error, this is very important. Google out. You ask the same question, how can I patent my? See, there are some private agencies also. They are ready to help you. Only thing is, you have to pay money. They will help you. They will fill the applications, everything. That is the reason NAC is asking you, how many capacity buildings you have, building program you have organized on IPR and patent rights?
Dr. Manu, someone has raised the hand. Kindly give them audio control to ask their question for last 2-3 minutes. Dr. Arneet Chawla. Ma'am, you can ask your question, please.
Sir, thank you, sir. Good evening. Sir, can I open my video also?
Yes,
certainly,
yes.
Certainly, madam.
Yes, please.
Certainly.
Yes,
please spell out your name, madam. I'll be happy.
Yes, sir. Sir, good evening. I'm Dr. Avneet from Chandigarh.
Yeah, Chawla.
I have been a keen traveler and researcher, and I elevated myself from school teaching, taught in schools for 12 years, and now 17 years in higher education, a UPSC selectee. I did my PhD 10 years back. Right. So I am a member of international organizations, and I went to, I'm a member of ISSBD, and it gave me a travel grant on the basis of global selection in 2010 for Zambia. And 2014 in China.
Yeah.
So on my own, I've done Penn State, I've done Connecticut, I've done Howard, I've done Princeton.
You should have replaced me today.
No, sir. I am learning, and I was the coordinator for this criteria for my college last time, for criteria 3, and I kind of have the feel of it. So my question is, sir, that when it came to the scores for NAC, my travel, it was called the earlier career scholarship by the criteria of having done it within the 7 years. So I could get the scholarship twice. But when it comes to the CAS calculations, I have not been given the credit of the award. It has only been treated as a travel support. Yeah. So which is not very encouraging. So am I right to ask for it or I qualify for it as an award towards my CAS calculation?
No, certainly, madam. You see, you got the travel grant and, you know, you continue to do your research. You know, if it falls on the assessment period, it will be taken cognition. Even if it does not fall on assessment period, you know, it will be taken cognition in the qualitative metrics. So your earlier achievement, we will appreciate you, you know, awarding, honoring you, you know, providing some points to your institution, even if it is earlier achievement, which is not taken cognition in the earlier accreditation.
So
qualitative metrics, you will be honored. You will be rewarded.
That's what, sir. Thank you, sir. That I qualify, my college gets the credit is one thing, but then I think I should have been, that should have been counted towards my CAS also. Am I right there? My particular question.
No, you see, that's what I see. There are some criteria, you know, which indirectly reward you.
Okay.
I mean, correct, reward you. See, because your initiative, you know, brought your institution into visibility. Am I correct, Arnold? Your travel grant.
They will get the credit. Yes, sir. Yeah. Definitely.
They will get the credit. So you can boldly tell your principal or your organization that your initiatives will be rewarded by NAC.
Just to apprise you, sir, I went to Harvard and Princeton in one go last year, and I got best paper from Harvard also last year.
Thank you very much. Very fortunate to have you as the participant of this great faculty development program organized.
Thank you to the host college also. Great listening to you, sir. Thank you.
Very, very fortunate to meet you, madam.
Thank you.
Congratulations, Dr. Ravi.
Thank you, ma'am.
Sir, another last question, that our higher education policy in India is monitoring standard of education through accreditation. They are awarding different grades of excellence.
Yeah.
However, the research outcomes of those particular institutions are not at par with the global index.
Yeah, so certainly.
Are your comments about, it was a very long question, I've just shot it.
Long question and a very, you know, very important question also for me to share.
Your comments about such accreditation.
Yeah. That's why, you know, I was very careful, you know, offering my ideas and keeping you updated, that don't bother about global citation index right now. Create social impact. That is very important. See, you have to win the confidence of NAC right now. If you start, you know, creating social impactful research, naturally, you know, after a couple of hours or a couple of, years, it will knock at global citation index. See, this is the thing, is a very important question. Perhaps it will enlighten me also. Very important question. See, let me start. Yes, for example, small drop of water make a mighty ocean. Am I correct or not? Small drop of water make a mighty ocean. If you start attempting the unanswered issues of the society, one day, you see, the Dappawala, there was one man who researched on Dappawala problems, and he created a scene globally. He created a scene globally, and he was asked to, he was not good at English. In fact, he was good at English, Hindi. But still, he had been invited by many institutions across the world to deliver lecture because they have translators. And he was able to improve English right now. Recently, I listened to him. Why I tell you, if you start with research which could address your immediate society, definitely it will knock at the global citation index also. You take the data, publish the data, original data, and write a beautiful article, definitely it will address the global index. You see, another important thing, as I told you, IIT Mumbai, they penetrate only rural and tribal society. And last year itself, they have got 80 international patents. Please visit IIT Mumbai site, website. You will understand. 80 international patents, they got it, penetrating the needs of the, addressing the needs of the tribal and rural society. I think you would have been convinced.
Yes, sir.
Certainly, it's possible.
One very last question is that somebody has asked that if he or she has purchased Urfund or some plagiarism software, personally purchased, can that same be used at the institutional level?
No, it can be used only for your self-assessment. You know, only Urfund must be used as far as UGC guidelines is concerned.
Right.
As far as top level journals are concerned, why not authenticate? Sometimes you can devise your own software. You can even evolve your own software, but it can be used only for your self-assessment so that you will be motivated. It should not be used for institutional level. Only Urfund.
That was a pretty long Q&A session. So thank you so much. I think you have satisfied everybody, and I don't think that anybody seems to be dissatisfied with any kind of process. Thank you so much. And now I hand over this mic to Dr. Rishpal Singh for the formal vote of thanks. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Dr. Rishpal Singh, please.
Thank you, Dr. Manjali. Thank you, Dr. Sir. On behalf of management, principal, the members of Mentee College, staff of G.A.G. Khalsa College of Education, Gurusar Sudhar. We thank you, Professor Dr. E. Ram Ganesh Ji, for exploring deeply the content of criteria third, that is research, innovation, and extension of NAC REF. Sir have explained each and every aspect of this criteria. I think all the participants have gained understanding and able to write self-study report for their institutions. Sir have beautifully explained the role of UGC in funding, improving research culture, put our potential, social impact of universities, capacity building, paradigm shift in research, promotion of the research, mobilization of resources, steps for incubation centers in various colleges. Chat box itself explains that this session was very informative, very interesting, very elegant, and nicely presented. Thank you, sir, for motivating us, for guiding us, and enriching us with criteria third of NAC. Thank you, dear participants, for the wonderful queries of this session. Again, thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, madam. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.